Airtable just unleashed a new set of features specifically for their interfaces. And this is allowing us to do things that we could not imagine before inside of Airtable's interfaces, specifically with conditional logic, the way you're able to look at things, and validation of data inside of forms. So if exploring these new features is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Hey, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth and I'm the owner at Gap Consulting. Here we help you to get organized and automated with no-code tools. And Airtable is one of the first and longest of those tools that we have loved from the beginning. And I'm excited to be talking to you about these new features. Before we get into the video though, first, quickly want to invite you to join me for some Airtable training. If you're still new to Airtable and you're trying to figure it all out, I have a free crash course that will be delivered to your email and you can go through and learn all the key features of this tool. Grab that crash course at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. I will include links wherever you found this video. But without further ado, let's go ahead and hop on into my screen. And we've got to talk about the first of these. And again, this all has to do with Airtable interface upgrades, new features coming to Airtable interfaces. And this first one is interface form validation. So there are a lot of different fields that you might be including inside of a form that you've built in your interface. And if that is the case for you, you can now control with some flexibility exactly what people can enter on these forms. Now, I need to preface this by saying this is only available for paid plans. So anyone on a team plan, a business plan, or enterprise scale, if you're using the free version, this is not going to pertain to you. Let's go ahead and hop on in and take a look. So here I've got a bunch of different field types set up. This first one is an email field type. I've also named it email, but the data that it's looking for is an email address. So here inside of this field, if I select it, you now see that on the right-hand side where I'm setting up the element, I can validate this as an email. So if anybody puts in an invalid email address, presumably this would flash a warning and let them know and not accept form submission until that was corrected. Now, we also have the attachment field type. I'm sure you've used this in Airtable plenty of times where we can actually store pretty much any file within reason inside of our database. Well, now we've got some settings for the attachments. So we can allow a specific type. So let's say, for example, you only wanted MP4s. So you can put in video/MP4 to only allow MP4 videos. Or you could say, look, I'm just looking for images like JPEGs. So here you go. Here's this code for that. You would just put in image/JPEG. Or if you want to allow any image, then you can just drop in image/star. So a lot of different options for you here, but essentially what you're doing is controlling the type of data that people are uploading into the form, which makes sure that you're getting the results you expect every time. So here I'm going to say I'm only looking for an image here. Let's go ahead and save that. And then we also get a max count. So we can control the total number of files that somebody goes ahead and uploads here into the form submission. So if I want to limit this just to one image per form submission, there we go. There's the one, I save it. So now this particular attachment field, when someone submits the form, is only going to accept images and is only going to allow one file per form submission. Now, some other field types, let's explore URLs. Here we can toggle on the validate URL feature so that if somebody puts something into this particular field on the form that's not a valid URL, it's going to reject that submission. Same thing with numbers. We can actually set up a range limit. So for example, if we want to ensure that everyone's using a positive number, we can put 0 in for the minimum. And maybe we want this number to be between 1 and 100. So we can set up the max and the min here and thereby control what people are entering in the form. Lastly, we have the option to do this with text. I'm showcasing this with a long text field, and here we have a character limit. So we can say by default, somebody has to have at least one character here in this text field, and we will cap it out, let's say at again, 100 different characters. So thereby controlling the amount of data that we're getting and making sure that it meets our criteria for this form. Now, of course, as in with any interface, when we're done, we have to publish. And of course, we want to test this. So let's check it out. Here I go. If I enter my email address, but I don't have the ending component here, you'll notice that it says this is not valid. Please update this to be a valid email address. I can come down and verify this with my attachment field type here. I've grabbed a screenshot and I'm uploading that here. So you'll see that it's taking this, but I do not have the ability to attach another file without first rejecting the other file. Same thing with URLs. Here I go with my web address here. If I don't have a valid web address, let's take this out and just say something like Gap Consulting. Well, now it's saying that is not valid. So of course I need to make sure that I have that HTTPS or something similar at the beginning that validates this as an actual URL. Same thing with my numbers. Remember, we're ranging between 0 and 100. So if I put 500 here, it should reject this and say it has to be 100 or less. So there we go. I can make it 50 and we're good. And the same thing with the text. It's going to count the number of characters and make sure that they are also validated. Now for the next one, this is something we've been waiting for a long time, and that is conditional logic inside of our forms. Now this one might be a little controversial because of the fact that this is only available, according to the website, on business and enterprise scale plans. So if you're on the lowest paid tier, the team plan, this is not supposedly available for you according to their pricing page and the updates that they've pushed out. Now here I am back inside of my form, and if I select one of the items in my form, you'll see that I have the visibility here to add some conditions to this. So I might say that the attachment field is only visible after email has been filled out. So something has to be in the email field before you're going to see the attachment field here. Now I want to pause and say that I'm actually demoing this on a team plan. And according to the website, as I mentioned, it says that this particular feature is only available for business and enterprise. I don't know if that will change in the future or if I just got lucky and happened to have this particular capability right now. I'm also suspicious that maybe it's available for forms, but the other part of this feature, which is going to be the third thing that I share in a minute, that I've tested and it's only available in my enterprise scale plan. So my guess is that the other portion, the other side of this feature, which I'll get to in a moment, is the part that is requiring the higher level tier. But for now, I just want to be transparent about the fact that I'm doing this inside of a team plan. Even though Airtable's website suggests that I should not be able to, so give it a shot. Maybe you'll have this capability, maybe not. But when I publish this, we can test this out. And again, we're going to go to this form, and you see that that is not available until I put in an email address, at which point, now that I have data here, the attachment field type is showing up. So you can think of all types of different conditional scenarios that you may set up inside of your interface forms and therefore control what people are able to see based on what they've done so far in the form. Now, for the last one that I've already hinted to, this has to do with conditional visibility inside of a record detail inside of your Airtable interface. That was a mouthful, so let's break it down. Here I am inside of an Airtable interface. I do have to point out that this particular interface is in an enterprise scale plan. And according to the website, just again, this requires that you're on a business plan or better. I tried this on my team plan. It did not work. So here I am inside of my interface. And basically, I have a calendar here that allows me to view all the different content that we plan for this channel. And we are able to open up right here. So right now, I've got this opened up right here. This is my calendar. I can expand the record view. Pretty straightforward. Well, now I have the ability to hide certain things inside of the record detail view based on conditions. Conditional visibility in an interface, finally here. I'm super excited. Let's look at it in action. This applies to both a group or individual fields. So here I am inside of my playlist field here. You can also see that all of these elements pertain to a group. So if I select the group, I've now had this group at the high level. On the bottom of my element here, you see that I have visibility rules. So I can set up rules to say, only show this particular section under certain conditions. Maybe valid on certain people being logged in. Maybe for some reason, this is private information and I only want to share it in the case where it's been posted in the year 2024. So then that would mean that I get the full list of all of my stuff on the calendar, but I can only see the details of that particular group if the record matches those specific conditions. Now, I can also take more advanced actions, like control what users can see what. And this is where we're really getting into true interface power. And this, therefore, enables us to build more streamlined interfaces and share certain components with certain teams or certain individuals. Very powerful stuff. Now, this also, as I mentioned, pertains to just at the field level, not just at the group level. So I can come in for playlists here. And again, I get that visibility function. Now, I think this is a little controversial because some people on the team plan are very, very big advocates for Airtable, and they just don't have the reason to upgrade to business. I'm curious to know what you think about the fact that this particular feature is not available on that team plan. However, I'm not entirely surprised that Airtable's going this direction. They've been telling us for quite a while now that their focus is on enterprise, and they are starting to differentiate their pricing tiers appropriately. So here we see it. This is the beginning of saying, hey, there are some really powerful utilities, some features that are only going to be available if you're spending premium dollars with Airtable. And let's be honest, at the end of the day, if we all want Airtable to succeed, I'm happy that they're doing something to differentiate and force people who are on the fence into that higher tier. Let me know your thoughts below in the comments. And of course, if I missed anything, be sure to drop that below as well. That's it for this one. In the meantime, my friend, keep on building.